On behalf of the elders, we'd like to thank everyone who's joined us this morning for the online lesson today. And we'd like to thank Logan for all the work he's done in getting this all set up for us. We do encourage all members at this time, if you are at home alone doing the worship, we do encourage you to possibly reach out, find another family's home to meet together so you can enjoy some fellowship at the same time as worshiping God. We do encourage everyone, though, that is sick, that has a fever or any symptoms at this time, please ensure that you stay away so that you do not possibly infect someone else. Do have a few announcements I just wanted to alert the church to. Former Southwest member and Southwest School of Bible Studies student Mark Diavola, who moved back to California due to complications from his heart and lung transplant, that was sometime last year, he has contracted the coronavirus. Please keep Mark and Jazz in your prayers. Their address is in the prayer list on the website under the members section. Cass Lutz, son-in-law of Betty Cluck, is hospitalized again at Baylor Scott & White with bile duct infection. He is a transplant recipient and high risk, so the family isn't allowed to visit him. And as always, on the website, you can find a list of those in need of prayers, as well as those that would like cards sent to them. Reminder that all other extra activities, Bible classes, and events have been canceled until further notice. Do want to also say something to the congregation that we hope that every member of the Lord's Church that meets at this location, as well as around the world, please take these opportunities that you have this time to reach out to friends and neighbors who might possibly be in need. See what you can do for them. This might provide us with an opportunity in the future to teach others when this temporary crisis has been resolved. You can remember Matthew 5:16, that we can let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works, that we might glorify God in heaven. I want to remind you all of that. I would also like to read a little short section from Matthew. Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34. It says, "Therefore I say unto you, be not anxious for your life, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than the food, and the body than the raiment? Behold the birds of the heaven, that they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather in barns, and your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are not ye much more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit unto the measure of his life? And why are ye anxious concerning raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God doth so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Be not therefore anxious, saying, What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Be not therefore anxious for the morrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." As the elders here, we would also welcome concerns or thoughts that you might have on the situation. Please feel free to contact one of us. But more importantly, we would appreciate any prayers that can be given on our behalf as we work through these issues. At this time, I'd like to lead us in a prayer. If you would bow with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you once again thankful for all the many blessings of this life that you have given unto us. We ask that thou be with us during these difficult times, that we remain faithful, that we continue in our studies, that we don't neglect the worship that we should have for you. We ask that thou will please be with the ones that were mentioned earlier, especially those in serious situations. We ask that thou would be with doctors that are working on potential cures. We ask that thou would help us in all things to remain faithful unto you, not to let our faith waver. Please continue to watch over us. Please help us through the course of our life. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I hope that you are all doing well today. I realize that our circumstances are not ideal, but I'm thankful that we have a godly eldership who is determined to find a way for us to be able to worship God. And I'm also thankful that God has blessed us with technology and the ability to be able to do what we're doing this morning. We trust the Lord that these things will soon pass and that we'll be able to continue gathering and worshiping and working as normal. But until then, we thank God for whatever avenue we have to be able to worship Him and to be able to build one another up. I want to direct our attention for just a few moments today to a few passages from the book of Lamentations, chapter 3. Just a couple of words about the book of Lamentations before we begin. Of course, the book is written by Jeremiah sometime immediately after the fall of Jerusalem to the Babylonians in 586 BC. And in this book, we have basically five different laments or lamentations, five different funeral dirges, if you will. And if you can envision Jeremiah, who was in the last group of captives that Nebuchadnezzar took, sitting upon the hill and overlooking the city of Jerusalem, watching it burn and watching its people be marched away into captivity, as he lamented and mourned and wailed the situation, we have his Holy Spirit-inspired words recorded for us in this great book. And I want us to notice together in just a moment, Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21 and following. And the reason that I've selected this particular section in this book is because while the book is surrounded by sorrow and heartache, in the middle of all of this sorrow and heartache is this very bright, very joyful, very encouraging statement, and I think that you'll find it to be familiar. Three things that we ought to have in our minds whenever we study Lamentations and whenever we look at the passages that we're going to look at in just a moment to help us maybe appreciate even greater what's going on. First of all, we ought to be aware of the very terrible suffering that was endured by God's people during this time in which Babylon came and destroyed Jerusalem. This is recorded for us in 2 Kings chapter 25. And if you go and read that chapter, you will see that when the Babylonians arrived, they besieged and built a wall around the city for approximately 2 years. They starved the people. They murdered Zedekiah's sons in front of his eyes and then gouged his eyes out. And as we read through 2 Kings 25 and as we read through Lamentations, we see references to things like famine and thirst and even cannibalism and rape and slaughter and all kinds of awful things that Israel, the people of God, were suffering at the hand of the Babylonians. And Jeremiah had a front row seat to all of these things. Another thing that we ought to keep in mind is the fact that these people, Israel, that they were experiencing the very real results of being rejected by God. Of course, we know from studying our Old Testament that God pled with the people over and over again to change their lives and to repent and to walk righteously before Him, but they refused to do it. And so in spite of all of his pleading and all of his patience, ultimately God raised up the Babylonians to enact the punishment and the justice that they rightly deserved. And yet while all of this is going on, certainly in the mind of the people, they had to have been thinking about the fact that they were, or had been at least, God's people, that God had dwelled among them and that God had taken care of them and provided for them and loved them, and yet now they're being given over to a ruthless enemy. And speaking of their enemies, that's another thing that we ought to consider as we read and study the book of Lamentations. Surely they must have been thinking, well, what about our enemies? The same kind of questions that were raised by Habakkuk in Habakkuk chapter 1 and 2. Remember, Habakkuk wanted to know how long God would allow unrighteousness and wickedness to go on amongst His people. And God's answer was, I'll tell you what I'm going to do, but you're not going to believe it. He says, I'm going to raise up Babylon, that wicked and hasty nation, and they're going to be my hand, if you will, of judgment upon the people. And so Habakkuk then was confused and wanted to know, how can you use a people that are even more righteous than your own to punish your people? And God would, of course, reveal the answer to him in that great three-chapter book. So unbearable suffering, rejection by God, and wondering about their enemies. All of these things stand in the background of what we're reading as we study the book of Lamentations, and particularly as we read through Lamentations 3, verse 21 to 24. I want you to notice with me in verse 19 of Lamentations 3 that Jeremiah says, "Remember my affliction and roaming, the wormwood and the gall, my soul still remembers and sinks within me." If you'll read the third chapter of Lamentations down through verse number 20, you're going to find language in which Jeremiah makes clear that his heart is broken and he is mindful of all of the suffering and the pain and the terrible experience that he and the people of God had endured. But then look at this ray of hope in verse number 21. In verse 16 to 20 especially, we have a description of hopelessness. But that gives way to hope in verse 21. He says, "This I recall to my mind, and therefore I have hope." So what is it that Jeremiah recalled to his mind that gave him hope? Look at the following passages. And notice that there are three things that Jeremiah will mention in the next few verses that are the things that he recalls to his mind and therefore give him hope. He says in verse number 22, "Through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is Your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in Him." Three things in these few verses. Number one, the reason why Jeremiah could say, "I have hope," is because of the Lord's mercies, verse number 22, or the Lord's great and steadfast love. Psalm 103 and verse number 4, the psalmist, as he proclaimed honor to God, he proclaimed the loving kindness and the tender mercy of God. In Psalm 103 and verse number 17, the psalmist says, "But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting." So as Jeremiah thinks about God, he thinks about the fact that God is a merciful God, or a faithful God, or a God whose love is absolutely steadfast and enduring, and that gives him hope. Second thing that he mentions is God's compassion. "Through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not." What does the Bible say about the passion or the compassion of God? In Psalm 86 and verse number 15, the psalmist exclaimed about the compassion of God. He said, "But You, O Lord, are a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in mercy and truth." He is described as the God of compassion in 2 Corinthians 1 and verse number 3. And in Psalm 103 and verse number 8, the psalmist said, David said, "The Lord is merciful and gracious and slow to anger, and abounding in mercy." Why does Jeremiah have hope in a seemingly hopeless situation? Because of His mercy, because of His compassion, and then notice the third, because of His faithfulness. "Great is Your faithfulness," he says in Lamentations 3 and verse number 23. "Faithful is He that promised," the Hebrews writer said in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 23. "He is the faithful God," Exodus chapter 34, verse 6 and 7. So stop for a moment and try, at least as best you can, and put yourself in Jeremiah's shoes. Having served God faithfully as a prophet for all of those years, having pled with the people of God to turn their minds and their hearts back to God, having been arrested and having been beaten and having been tried and having suffered all that he did on the behalf of God, and yet still the people rejected, the people refused to listen, and they're taken into captivity. And Jeremiah sees every bit of this with his own eyes. He experiences it. He has a front row seat. And yet in all of this, he says, I have hope because of the Lord's mercy and because of the Lord's compassion and because of the Lord's faithfulness. And the point is obvious. There is no greater hope to be found in any situation than considering our God and His character and His love for us, namely His mercy and His compassion and His faithfulness. There is a song that is one of my favorites that is based upon this context of Scripture, and the song is simply titled, Great is Thy Faithfulness. It was written by a man named Thomas Chisholm, who was born in 1866. He was a teacher and the editor of a local newspaper, and he struggled with poor health all of his life, and his poor health forced him to be unemployed at different times or left him unemployed at different times, and so his life greatly was a struggle. But he was a poet, and he wrote over 1,200 poems, and in 1925, he wrote the words, the poem, in the form of a poem for this song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Being asked about this, he would say that there was no single event in his life that brought him to the point of writing these words, but rather, when he came to the end of his life, he made this statement. He said, my income has not been large at any time due to impaired health in the earlier years, which has followed me on until now. And although I must not fail to record here the unfailing faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God, and that He has given me many wonderful displays of His providing care, for which I am filled with astonishing gratefulness. In other words, what he said is, it's not one instance in my life that has caused me to stop and write these words about the unfailing faithfulness of God, but rather it is the sum total of my life and how He's always been there and He's always provided faithfully so. He talks about the faithfulness of God's character. Great is Thy faithfulness, he says. O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. He talks about the faithfulness of God seen and how He blesses us with what we need physically. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, sing with all nature in manifold witness of Thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. He also writes about the faithfulness of God seen in spiritual blessing. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine and 10,000 beside. As we think about the words that he has written, I think that I would be safe in saying that if we honestly stop and think about the sum total of our lives, we can see the faithfulness of God's character. We can see the faithfulness and how God has provided for us the things that we need physically. And we certainly can see the faithfulness of God and how He has provided for us spiritually as well. So now to bring all of this to a close, when we think about Lamentations chapter 3, verses 19 and following, when we think about the mercy and the compassion and the faithfulness of God, it ought to produce within us an overwhelming feeling of joy and peace and hope and gratitude. And again, I realize that the circumstances now are not exactly the best, but I also know that there have been many times throughout the history of our world where people have struggled through, God's people have struggled through times just as difficult and even more difficult than what we see now currently in our world. Let me just encourage you to think about these few things over the coming days and hours ahead as we deal with different circumstances that are going on in our world. Use this as an opportunity to excel in prayer. Use it as an opportunity to think carefully about what the Bible says about prayer, about how we're to pray always without fainting, Luke 18, verse number 1, to pray without ceasing, 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse number 21. Take time maybe to read through the Psalms and notice how the psalmist addresses God, this great, compassionate, and faithful, and merciful God, in prayer. Use this also as an opportunity to focus on spiritual things and spiritual priorities. The Bible does tell us in passages like James chapter 1, verses 1 and following, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the testing of your faith produces patience. Trial has to do with a testing of faith. It has to do with the difficult circumstances of life. And the Bible says that those things can be good for us because they help us to stop and take inventory about what's really, really important. And it's not material things. It's not material wealth. It's no physical reality. Rather, it's the God that we serve and things of a spiritual nature. Focus on making those things priorities. Number three, remember your brethren. Pray for one another. Call and check on one another. So many are struggling alone, maybe because their spouse is no longer here with them. Or maybe it's the case that we have some who are dealing with sickness, and maybe we have some who are just very concerned and they could use some reassurance. Remember your brethren. Next, remember the work of the kingdom. I appreciate Mark mentioning the fact earlier that even in a time like this, we may have opportunity to let our light shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our God in heaven. Remember that even in a time like this, the work of God and the work of kingdom still goes on and still takes priority. So look for opportunities in order to further the cause of Jesus Christ. But most importantly and finally, remember God and remember His character. And remember the fact, as Jeremiah said, that we have hope, and there is no greater hope than that which is found in our God.